Hi, Gerald 200. How are you? It's me on the rehab. And so today is Tuesday, April 3rd, 2018. I decided to give you a little break, let you focus on getting your CT2s in. They weren't that difficult. It's only 2 pages long. How people can continue to not put it into their own words when it's 2 pages long. It's kind of mind blowing, and especially something like this. I guarantee you, 70% of you are going to have to deal with diabetes at some point in your life. Heart disease, Alzheimer's, all these are very relevant issues. So putting out a 2-page effort is not that big a deal. And and speaking about effort, what I'm going through right now is what all of you may go through someday, especially if I'm speaking to the athletes. Rehab from an injury is a full-time job, full-time, and it's incredibly painful, but you have to do it. You have to push through it, or else you will be disabled later on in life, and nobody wants that, right? A big part of gerontology is the perception of older people, and their perception is they don't want to become a burden. You don't want to become a burden to your siblings. You don't want to become a burden to your children. You want to live life independently, really based on your own ideals and your own rules. Okay, so I know none of you probably have gone through this, whether it's from an auto accident or from a sports injury or whatever. And rehab is a serious thing. And I spend hours every day trying to get back some kind of range of motion. And I'm sure a number of you have had parents that have had a knee replacement done, and it's a serious deal. Okay. All right. Enough about me, but I do want to put that out there because I want you guys to think about this. Okay. We are in the wheelhouse of most of you right now. This is the business aspect of being a gerontologist. Okay. And really, many of you by default become gerontologists because you become financial planners, okay, money managers, wealth managers, whatever type of title you want to put on it, okay. It's one of those things where you become a person who's seriously involved in investing, okay. It's an easy first step right out of college to become a money manager, a wealth manager, a financial planner. And you should know what you're talking about, okay? And so when we look at the readings over the last couple of weeks, okay, I'm clicking right on to our reading list, okay? And we look at last week's, okay, right here. It was kind of just a wake-up call, okay? And we're looking at right in here. We're looking at, how people are able to survive financially into long life. Okay. And if you haven't gotten things figured out from this course, gerontology, medicine, whatever, it's all about increasing the years to life, the quality of life. And by default, with science and advances, people are gonna live forever. Okay. And so you have to figure out if you're ready or not for retirement. And so all the different things we're going to do. So this was really kind of social economics, okay? And considering the economic readiness of people in our country, we looked at, for example, in the discussion, Social Security, okay? What you need to do, okay? I think the reality is for everybody that I'm speaking to right now, I know the reality for me is I'm going to work till I'm 72, okay? This way, I'll maximize my Social Security benefit, okay? And in addition, okay, I will also be generating income from the workplace, okay? So it's all good. So I'm gonna have to defer this, okay? This is better for me, better for my family, okay? I will continue to draw from my own personal health care instead of relying on Medicare, okay? You have a lot more options when you use your own personal health care. The doctor that I went to go see, he is the bomb, the guru of the South Orange County, okay? His name is Robert Gorab, and he does not take Medicare. Boom, Okay, so you have to have good health insurance. I talked about my wife's situation, okay, Julia, okay. We really cannot afford to have Medicare covering her cancer coverage because we need to have more choices, okay? So she's 7 years younger than me, so therefore I really need to work until I'm 72. First of all, she's not even going to qualify for Medicare, okay, for another 7 years, all right? So if I were to jump into Medicare, she'd have no health care coverage. So these are all very real financial issues. Okay, so going back to this, there's a discussion of pension. You know who gets pensions? Next to nobody. Okay, that is old school. Government workers get pensions, and even then, this is a very hot ticket political item where all of us are paying our tax dollars to finance the pensions of firemen, policemen, city workers, anybody that work for a state or the federal agency, our political friends that are members of Congress and the Senate get pensions. Where is this all going to head? Okay, I don't get a pension. I have what's called a defined contribution. Okay, which is what we're going over today. Okay, alrighty. And so this is a big part of literacy and planning, is knowing where you stand. Okay, and this is what you need to do as financial planners, guys. So you need to sit your client down, okay, and develop a 15, 20, 30-year plan, a reality check. Okay, how much do you spend now? What do you see your expenditures, later on in life? Okay, our house. Okay, we refinanced, a while back. Okay, so my note. Okay, that's $1,750 a month. Not huge. Okay, because we bought, '98 originally, but still $1,750 a month that I'm going to be paying until I'm about 73 years of age. And then I will own my house free and clear. Okay, so these are all things that come into your planning with your clients. Okay, all right. So this is a great chapter. Okay, looking at our society, understanding, what people have. Okay, so we have Social Security, and a lot of people, that is all they have. Mind blowing. Okay, then we have our savings, okay, our assets, all right. So and then we have whatever money we can work from get generate from work, okay, which is what I'm doing right now. Okay, so that's a broad spectrum, and many people have zero assets. Okay, and that's what we learned when we looked at our subsequent discussion. I'm going to click right into that. So this gives you relevance on this. So if we go into our discussion, okay, and we looked at this, hopefully this blew some of your minds, okay, and you look at this chapter right here, we talk about savings, okay, and I'm going to go into the chapter right here, okay, and we're looking here at retirement savings. Again, this is the mean, okay, so that would be the average. That means a lot of people that have saved a lot. Sorry. So the people that have a lot of money saved, excuse the average. I think the more important thing is not to look at the average, but as we indicated down here, to look at the median. Okay, so we have approaching 380 million people here in the, here, let me put my head right there. Awesome. Right over Quicken Loans. 380 million people in our country. Okay, so if we would look at the median, okay, we see, and that'd be half the people that are in this age group that should be sitting there just, simmering about going into retirement. Okay, we see that half the people have only $17,000 saved. Mind-boggling, mind-boggling. Okay, and you see how this has gone down, 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 down. So something bad is happening in terms of our social economics. Okay, so you guys, the financial planners, got to help people out. Okay, now I'm also sending you another article from the Atlantic, and it just kind of reiterates this article right here that we're looking at, that was CNBC. Okay, and this is the article from the Atlantic, and it says, "What is life without retirement? What this is what life looks like without retirement savings." Okay, alrighty. So and so it talks about individual people and what they live on, and it's kind of mind-blowing that this is the reality. But then it comes back down here and it says, again, many people reaching retirement age don't have the pension that lots of workers in previous generations do. In fact, 98% of us don't have pensions. And often, they have not planned, okay, so they don't have a defined contribution, okay? And they don't have 401ks, they don't have individual retirement accounts that we were looking at earlier, okay? All right, so if we look again here, between ages 55 and 64, we see that the median, like I said before, is $15,000. $15,000. So that should blow your minds. Okay. So also what I want to do is I'm going to include something, and I'm gonna have to find it here real quickly, that I want to show you guys. Okay, so hold on a sec. And I'm going to go over here to my courses, okay? And it's just a real quick go-to that I've generated for Gerald 200. All right, here we go, spring 2018. And I'm going to call this a discussion update, okay? Financial planning, okay? And so I'm going to be sending you this Excel spreadsheet, okay? And there it is, okay? So this is what you kind of need to know to coach the basics. These are two links that you can use to get more information. And these are about individual retirement accounts, okay? So we have 401ks, individual retirement accounts, and Roth individual retirement accounts, okay? All righty. So we're looking right here, okay, at the limits that you can put into your accounts, okay? Annual limits, okay, and we see that 401ks are much better than IRAs. As you get older, you can put more in, but this is your annual limit. So I can, as an individual, I can put $24,500 into my 401k from USC. If I didn't have a 401k, then I can do an IRA. Okay, alrighty. So when we look at the taxation, okay. So this is taxed after retirement withdrawal. That's how my 401k works, okay? So so right now, if I make a lot of money, I'd be in a higher tax bracket for that money. But no, I'm shielding it, okay? And what I'm doing is I'm taking it out before my taxes are assessed, and I put it into my 401k. And then maybe when I'm 80 years of age, I won't be spending, you know, $250,000 a year like I do right now, okay? Maybe I'll only spend $100,000 a year, and that would be a lower tax bracket. Okay, so that's how that works. Okay, so it's after retirement tax income. All right, in terms of what we have, okay, we have mutual funds. We're going to talk about that. Okay, you can make them target dates so that they automatically become more conservative. Okay, right now, I can take risks maybe. As you get older, you don't want to take risks because if it takes 3, 4, 5 years for the stock market to come back, you may be in a sorry situation. All right, we're looking at an individual retirement account. The standard IRA is, again, taxed after retirement withdrawal. So it's just like our friend over here, the 401k, okay? And it's the same thing. It's treated as after retirement taxable income. So when I'm 80 years of age, if I take $100,000 out of my IRA, I'll be in that $100,000 a year tax bracket, okay? Now, the Roth IRA is different, okay? This is taxed at the time of your investment, okay? So maybe that's a good idea if you're really young, if you're less than 50 years of age, okay? And you're in a lower tax bracket right now. So you're making maybe, you know, $60,000 a year. You start putting in that Roth IRA, it's gonna be, because you're only making 60 grand a year, it's not gonna be taxed that much, because your present income is not that big. But then down the line, when you're older, you can pull out as much as you want, okay? It was already taxed, okay? So you can pull out 200 grand a year if you want and know that that you've already paid your taxes. That's kind of how that works. Alrighty, I also did a little cheat sheet down here on some investment strategies. Okay. So, what you should be doing is investing in mutual funds. Nobody can predict the stock market. Nobody can predict individual stocks and how they're going to work. It's fun, you know, it's risky. Okay. You bundle your equities. Okay. Stocks are thousands and thousands of companies bundled into a category. Okay. Like the S&P 500, like NASDAQ. Those are just examples. Dow Jones. Okay. And so you invest in these categories of hundreds and thousands of companies. Bonds, you can also invest in. These are loans that you make to companies or to the government. Okay, all righty. There are fees, okay, that are associated with all these. Okay, but they are much lower than dealing with a financial planner, okay, or a broker. All right. So while some of you are going to make a career out of being a financial planner, I'm telling you right now, you don't need financial planners, guys. You guys are smart. You know how to use your computers. It's easy peasy. You set up an account with Fidelity, okay? You set up an account with Vanguard, and it's like a video game. It's super fun and it's super easy. Anybody can do it, okay? Why have somebody else lose all your money for you? We can do it yourself, okay? All righty. One kind of more modern fund of kind of mutual funds, or these things called exchange traded funds. Okay, the difference of these, okay, it's the same thing. You have bundled equities, you have bundled bonds. Okay, same kind of categories. Okay, difference in terms of minimum investment. Okay, and you can do real-time trading on these, so you can feel like you're a stockbroker, whereas the mutual funds are reassessed at the end of the day. Okay, all righty. Here's a little cheat sheet on bonds. Okay, the whole deal with a bond is they're purchased at a certain value with a guaranteed dollar amount of return based on that purchase price. Okay, and the percent rate of return at the time of the purchase is charged for the loan. Okay, so you have government and this return. Okay, where you have this guarantee is a yield. Okay, so when you hear that yields are going up, that's not a good thing. Okay, if I have a 5% yield, that means 5% of $100, I'm going to get $5. Okay, all right. If the yield is going up, I'm still only going to get $5. That means the percentage is going up to cover that $5 because the value of my bond is tanking. Okay, and that's what happens when interest rates get higher. Okay. All right, so that's, you know, don't be misled by this concept of, oh, yields are going up. That's a great thing. No. It just means that we're having to have a higher percentile basis for the bond's value, so you get your $5. Okay, you want yields to be low. Actually, you're gonna get your $5, but that means your the value of your bond is at what you purchased at, or maybe even higher. So when you sell it, you make money. Okay. All right, so those are the basics, okay, of financial planning, okay, and you guys should be able to handle all of this, okay. All right, so this is calling long-winded, but I thought, you know, since most of you in this class are business majors, this is the natural marriage between gerontology and between financing financial planning, and either it's your career or it's your own individual planning of your own retirement, which you can easily do without a financial planner just by getting educated on how to use websites like Fidelity and by websites like Vanguard. Okay, alrighty. God bless everybody. Pray for my wife Julia. Like I told you, she's in a clinical trial, and it is what it is. The cancer's still there, and the treatment's harsh, and the shit is hitting the fan, and it's a bummer. So, all right, guys. So, hang in there, and we'll see you next time. Almost.